My name is Abby Haler. I'm a medium and energy worker and co-founder of Sensory Soul Science.
My name's Lucy Wise. I have a keen interest in paranormal activity and volunteer for Sensory Soul Science.
Hi, my name's Amy Dutton. I'm part of the Sensory Soul Science team and I am a paranormal investigator.
I'm here today with a local historian, Pete, who's going to tell us a little bit about the old oak tree that stands behind me here at the junction.
Yeah, hello Lucy. Yeah, the tree's approximately 500 years old. As you can imagine, it's seen a lot of history. It's seen the birth and the death through to because of the fire of the Baginton Hall. It's also got a bit of history as regards as a young lad called Elliot,
right,
supposedly lived in there. Obviously he's dead now because we're going back a fair few years, but he's still supposed to be in existence occasionally. He has been heard and seen.
That could be interesting when we're investigating later on this evening.
It's, well, you don't know, he might just put in a guest appearance for you.
So how famous is the tree?
Locally, very, but I mean you can move out of the area, no. But it is recognised as one of the oldest oak trees in the country.
Welcome, I'm Amy Dutton, reporting for Sensory Soul Science. We're currently at Baggett's Castle. I'm here with Duncan. Welcome, thank you for your time today.
Thank you. I'm a volunteer for Baggett's Castle Trust to look after the castle here.
Okay, and can you tell us any history on the grounds of
the castle? Has got a tremendous history. It goes back almost to the Doomsday Book, not the castle you see behind me here at the moment. The castle you see behind me was actually built in about 1350, 1380, somewhere around about there, by a guy called William Baggett. So William Baggett, he was quite a prominent person at the time. He was a member of Parliament. He was a bit of a rogue by all accounts, though. He was friendly with people he wanted to be friendly with, who thought they would do him a bit of good. So he was very friendly with Richard II, who was Richard II before he was Richard II. And they had a few important people staying at the castle, not for a long period of time, but they stayed here for odd periods, odd weekends, odd days, and again. The castle itself was in use for about 100 years, but it did fall into disuse in about 1400, 1500, somewhere about there. It changed hands after Sir William Baggett died in 1407. It was taken over by the Goodyear family, who didn't look after it terribly well. They sold it eventually to a local church, and it fell into disrepair subsequent to that in about 1500, 1600, thereabouts.
Okay.
So since then, it has been just a ruin. But it's a ruin that we've resurrected. We've tried to do our best with making it suitable for the public, so that the public can come and see the castle.
And these are the ruins behind us.
That's it. That's the ruins behind us.
Can you tell us about the ruins?
Yeah. Immediately behind that, behind the castle, you can see there's a green, flat green lawn. And behind that is what we call a summer house. It's the remains of a summer house. The summer house was built by the Bromleys in 1840 or thereabouts. The idea that they had was that they had Baginton Hall, they were residents of Baginton Hall, they wanted a recreation area. So they came down to the castle here, they filled in what is now the green part you can see behind me, and they built the summer house for recreational purposes. We're not quite sure what recreational purposes, but we have recreational purposes that they had.
Okay, that's brilliant. Thank you so much for your time, Duncan.
Yeah,
thank you. This is Amy Dutton reporting for Sensory Soul Science. We look forward to doing paranormal investigating later. So Pete, we're here at Baginton, we're here in the grounds of the old
church. As you can see, it looks obviously that it's a very, very old building. The surrounding areas along here were the perimeter walls of the old hall, wasn't they?
Correct, yeah. Which extend around, right round onto the main road down
onto
there.
Onto the main road.
Onto the main road, yeah.
And what's that you've got in your hands there again?
This is the sale of the Baginton estate on October 11th, 1918. And in here, there's a little bit of history as regards Lot 11.
Yeah.
And Lot 11,
yeah,
which was the pleasure grounds.
Oh, yeah.
The lofty avenue of lordly avenue of Lofty Lime.
Yeah.
The original mansion, the gardener's cottage, a well-timbered park, ornamental fish ponds.
And that there is a photo, isn't it?
And it was all sold for £2,500.
Gosh,
that was all.
That must have been a lot of money in those days.
Oh, in those days, when you consider they were picking up farthings and halfpennies in wages.
Yeah, yeah.
So,
but it was the original. That's the catalogue, is it?
This is the catalogue
of the auction.
Of the auction, the auction was at the Masonic Hall, Coventry, at 2 o'clock precisely.
Yeah.
By director of Colonel W. Bromley at Davenport.
And that was the owner of the land itself.
That was the owner of the land.
So the Bromleys sold their lands in 1918.
Yeah. And if you look
fabulous.
At that one,
mm-hmm.
I don't know, can you get a close-up on there? There's Baginton.
Yep.
You've got Wrighton on Dunsmore, Stoneleigh, Bubble. All of that belonged to the Baginton Hall.
That's right.
Yeah.
Yeah, fantastic. Thank you for bringing that document.
Not a problem.
If we just walk a bit further, yeah. As you can see, for the benefit of the viewers, as we walk towards this area here from the church, this is the existing wall. And this pathway here used to go straight through from the hall itself, because the hall was on those grounds. And it used to come through here to the church. And this is the way that some of the children who used to live in the hall would have come through to the school. And as you can see over there, we've got Amy and Lucy, and they're just having a little look at the perimeter of the wall. And you can see the railings themselves there, they existed in conjunction with the church. And on the maps and deeds, ranging from 1886, this walling terrace used to go, the iron terrace, used to go all the way across around in a semicircle at the back of the old hall. Further down later on, we're going to be taking you to an area where some of that still exists. So as we walk through, Pete and I are just going to have a little talk and we'll meet you on the other side. As you can see, we've just come through the walkway from the church and the camera's taking a shot of the grounds. We're actually currently stood, aren't we, Pete, on the walkway right the way through, all the way from there where we were before going through the church grounds, right the way down to what area would that have been down there, Pete? What area would that have been?
The original building was just here.
Yeah.
This is the footpath at the rear of the house.
Yep.
And down there, there would have been, the evidence is there, of a turning circle where the carriages and coaches would come in, they would turn in readiness to
deliver
whatever it was going on, yeah.
Where the stables and the laundry area were.
Yes, down
okay.
here, because there is still a cottage down here,
yep.
which was part of the original estate. There's a gentleman living in there.
And it's still standing today?
It's still standing to this day.
Fantastic.
And of course the avenue of trees, which you've got a photograph of, was down there.
Oh yes, we will be touching on that
yeah.
subject, because
yeah.
it is quite, at the very, very end of the walkway, there are paranormal sightings, we're going to talk about later.
Which is the Grey Lady.
Yes, that's correct, the Grey Lady.
I'll leave that, that's your forte.
Yeah, but the hall itself used to stand on the area of land to our left.
Yeah, right in front of us.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Now, the hall was built originally in 1680,
yeah.
and it was burnt down in 1706.
Yeah. Rebuilt.
Rebuilt.
And then, unfortunately, burnt down again late 1800s.
So twice the hall has been
burnt
down on this land.
Twice the hall was burnt down.
it seems really strange that that's happened. It's occurred for the people who had the hall, the family, the Bromleys, because for a hall to be of such grandeur in an estate like it is, in a very small village in Warwickshire, to me, for it to be burnt down twice, it seems very strange, doesn't it? Very strange.
Well,
the thing is, what we've got to remember is, why was it burnt down? I believe...
An accident in the kitchen?
Yeah, that's right. We did have a suggestion to us made about paraffin on the second date of the burnings, but... And that was 1889, wasn't it?
Correct.
There's a lady that we have spoke to as well that lives over on Riley Road.
Jenny Wilkins.
Jenny Wilkins. And isn't that bizarre that your surname's Wilkins as well?
She could be a distant relative of mine.
Yes, she could indeed.
Yeah. She was born and bred in what was... not the ruins. I mean, there weren't ruins. She wasn't born in ruins. But part of the house... wasn't burned down, which is the west wing here.
Yes, on this side.
She was born and bred in it.
Right, okay. So she was born in the west wing.
Yep.
Right, and she moved out of that area where she was a youngster, I believe.
Yeah.
And she had memoirs, and we have had a little chat to her, but that will be shown later on for the documentary, by the way, folks. We need to let you know everything about the history of this beautiful hall. Considering that it's actually been burnt down twice and the paranormal sightings around this area are of a grey lady, we do feel as if it warrants an investigation this evening. But I'd like to say thank you to Pete for helping us with our history and helping me resource and find information with regards to the hall. Hello, and again we're here in another location that's connected to the old hall. This area is now currently the car park to Baginton Village Hall. You can be able to hear a few people around us because there is a fete going on the front lawn of the old hall area. Right behind me is a platform of grass, which is actually where the old hall used to stand. This was the frontage of the old hall, and right to my right hand side there was a facade of trees, a lined avenue. Continuing with our documentary about Baginton Old Hall, behind me is the old gate priors, the original gate priors that still stands to this day. Just as you go further through these gates, behind the bungalow that is the housing of these gates, we can actually tell you that there has been paranormal activity occur in a property which is smack bang on the old driveway. The lady who owns the house has informed Sensory Soul Science that they do have paranormal activity within their home. We have been allowed to film here today with the courtesy of this person who owns the building behind us. But to look at the structure of the actual wall, as we walk along shortly, you'll see some still photography of the actual boundaries. The original boundaries, which now house behind them today's residences. Everybody has a home behind this boundary wall.
Again, as Abby mentioned earlier, the remains of the wall for the old Baginton Hall still remain, and I'd just like to show you this red brick. As you can see, I'm walking beside it now.
happened.
This was the original back drive to the hall and the quarters. This was where everybody used to come for the deliveries. The turning circle was right here. And to my left, there would have been a building, and it was called the conservatory. And the conservatory was the only building that anybody could come and deliver through. There's a wall which you will see shortly on some more footage, which actually stands. The footings are still there. This wall was the perimeter wall to cover any of the servants' quarters. The hall was a little further to the left, and the fascia of the back of the terrace was just 20 metres behind where I'm stood. Just down there is another building, and that exists to this day, and there is a resident in there. This building is actually part of the existing liveries. This was the laundry, and shortly, in the space of the next hour, we'll be going further down there and filming in that direction. Stood right in front of the old laundry. This was a building that was connected to the old hall. The fascia of the building is actually white sandstone. This would have been exactly the same as what was on the fascia of the old hall. It was built around the same time. This building still exists, and it is now currently a residency. As you can see, the chimney on the top, you can see the age and the red brick. In the rendition of when the hall was burnt down in 1889, there is reference to the red brick of the internal structure of the building, and the fascia was the white stone that you can see today on this building here. So it gives you a little bit of an understanding of exactly what the hall would have looked like in its grandeur.
Right, Abby, I noticed that this here is obviously part of the wall, but what about this piece here?
Oh, these pieces.
Can you tell me a bit more about these?
Yeah. Well, when the hall was burnt down in 1889, we did have a written rendition of exactly what happened during the fire. And parts of the lead on the roof was molten down. And this happens to actually be that. It is actually part of the roof of the hall that we've sourced and brought back so everybody can see for themselves during the documentary what it was like for the fire.
It is evidence of what actually happened.
Yes.
Is this the actual sink?
Yeah. This here is part of a sink that was in the laundry area, around the laundry area at the back of the hall. We do have other sections of it, which actually makes up the majority of the actual sink. That was used by the servants to wash all the clothes in the hall.
That's amazing that it was used 400 years ago.
Yeah.
In the old hall,
it was here. Yeah, it was used. The hall was burnt down in 1706, and then it was rebuilt in 1714. So this actual piece here is more than likely around the 1714 to the middle of that century.
It's evidence as well of the year.
It is indeed.
It's been a stone sink.
Yeah, it is.
Very, popular.
I'm just interested in the little artifacts, Abby. What can you tell us about these? Like, are these, do you think, ornaments or something that may have been in the hall originally? And the medicine bottle?
The medicine bottle was found actually on the site where the hall existed. That would have actually been part of the medicine cabinet. This here and all these little pieces were all found in the laundry area. This would have been where a lot of the washing up and other things were taken to the kitchen, the back of the house.
Right.
All these pieces were found actually in the ground where the old laundry servants' quarters were at the back of the house, through the back of the house, which was the conservatory. And whilst we're talking about everything, as we know, the hall actually had a fire. It had two. These artifacts that we have here are from the second fire. There's an article which stipulates that the red brick of the internal walls was actually the only thing that was remaining and seen, and it was charred. This is, as you can see, a charred piece of the actual walls, interior of the walls. This section here is actually a charred piece again, which was there back in their day. It was there Their style of plastering is very, very tough, but as you can see yet again, it's covered in char. And there's the red brick fascia on the other side, so it would have literally have been on the inside walls covering it. And also there, this section here is again charred brick. This area here, we're actually looking at the stone fascia. The hall was actually made of this, which is white sandstone. So this would have been and is the existing frontage of the actual hall itself. There are many pieces of this available here, but there were many chunks that actually fell off and cracked away from the hall due to the heat of the hall when it was on fire. And the last piece, we've talked about the wall. This is a section of the wall, and this would have been literally around the turning circle at the back of the drive, where we used to have the people come along in the horses and carts and bring things, deliveries, to the back of the hall. And this was found on the site at the back of the hall, around that area where the turning circle was, the capstone at the top. Around the whole of the village, there are pieces of this wall, which you will see on the documentary that we filmed and still photoed. And the last thing, this is a capstone of a top of the piece of the wall that was from the 1614 period. This piece of stone was the original walling, and this was part of the boundary, which was on the corner, not far up from the gate priors that exists and stands today. So we just thought that we'd talk about these artifacts because they're of great historical importance. We said we'd pieced together every single aspect of the perimeter walls of the old hall. We currently stood right behind the old wall that was for the drive. The driveway used to pan all the way across from the front of the old hall. And this, now to this day, is a current non-right of way, as in nobody can build anything on it because it was the access to the original old hall. It's currently slap bang in the middle of Baginton, and the grandeur of the old wall. Just behind this were the trees of the Lime Avenue. This wall and another wall further down, which has now been knocked down, used to be the perimeter walls to the Lime Avenue. And if you look straight across and down, you can imagine this would have gone all the way down, straight the way down, very, very far, possibly half a mile down that way this wall would have been. Later on, we're going to tell you where the Lime Avenue ended, and this is where the story starts for this evening with the Grey Lady of Baginton. We are currently stood right here on a spot that has recurrent sightings of the Grey Lady. This area here would have been the old hall's last tree, basically the entrance into the old hall. If you have a look that way towards the trees in the distance, the hall would have had an avenue of trees that went all the way from where we stood right the way to the furthest distance of the tallest tree. That's where the fascia of the old hall would have stood. The avenue of trees came down right to this spot, and in 1984 this couple saw an apparition of the Grey Lady just in front of me on Round Road. She was pointing in the direction of Coventry Airport and then in the direction of the Roman Fort. At that time, the people who spotted the apparition of the Grey Lady would not have known that this was the original ending to their hall at that point in their time. The apparition was physically stood on the spot where she was witnessing a fire, beckoning people to come forward to the hall She was pointing in the direction of the main entrance to the hall, and she was also pointing in the direction to the back entrance. You know where we filmed earlier and showed you the capstones, showed you the gate priors? Well, she was pointing in that direction. That happens to be directly opposite the Golden Roman Fort. This couple thought that the lady was trying to tell them something. Many sightings have been seen in Baginton since. Many sightings of the Grey Lady were seen in the 1900s. The hall was seen on fire in the 1900s, when it was no longer there. Tonight we're going to investigate Baginton. We're going to investigate the land of the old hall. We're going to do our best to show you the real world of the paranormal.